For CMA is for the investment banking purposes. I'm in the field of the investment banking.
Not investment banking. Investment banking is CFA, Chartered Financial Analyst. That's the course for investment banking. Okay, but okay. that does not mean an investment banking will not hire a CMA. Okay, so there are two different things. Okay, if you want to get into managing investments, okay, if you want to be a mutual fund manager, or you want to be a financial advisor, then CFA is the course. Okay? Because that is purely towards investment banking, Chartered Financial Analyst. CFAs, that's purely towards investment. It's more weighted towards investments, markets, and all that. CMA has got to do with a mix of manufacturing and business. So even an investment banker, so if you take, for example, somebody who was a KPMG, who worked with KPMG, KPMG will still hire you. KPMG has also got a branch of investment banking. Not necessarily they'll hire you in that branch, but maybe, in a different branch. Let's take a pure investment bank. Okay. Let's take a pure investment bank. Even a pure investment bank will hire you because they need somebody to study the financial statements of the companies before they recommend the investment. So they will hire you. They will ask you to study the financial statements. They will ask you to analyze the financial statements. They will ask you to, give your opinion. Do you think this company is financially strong or not? Is it worth investing or not? So that is why you will fit in. Right? Prashant, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome. Anybody else? Any other question? Okay. Let me introduce myself.
Sanjay, there's one more question.
Yes.
You're talking about upskill. You're talking about some certain upskills, yes. Technology that will be beneficial for a future growth, yes. And all this. So, what kind, yes. of upskills are you recommending?
See, So a lot of companies now require you to know financial modeling, for example, data analytics.
Mm-hmm.
Related to finance field, data analytics related to finance field. So all these are, new technologies, which if you have some kind of a knowledge or a background, okay, you will get a preference when they hire you. See, everybody knows debit credit. Everybody knows, journal entries, ledger posting, trial balance sheet. Everybody knows. Okay. But how do you use that to add value? Okay? So if you, for example, if you know financial modeling, if you know about how to do a financial modeling, that means you're one step ahead other than just reading the financial statements. You can use the data to model something for the future. Right? So that is what I meant by upskilling. Does that answer your question, Rizwan?
Yes, I got it. Yeah.
That is why you see technology and analytics has been added to part one. That is the reason they have added technology and analytics. Okay. For example, somebody who's working on SAP applications. Okay. If they know a little bit about how, the transactions are distributed in a SAP application. When you make an entry, how does it get distributed? Okay. It will help them. It is not necessary. It is not mandatory, but it is a useful knowledge or skill to have. Sure. Anybody, sure. Any other question?
Thank you so much, Sanjay.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much,
Anybody
Sanjay.
Anybody else?
Sir.
You're welcome. Anybody, any other question? Yes, artificial intelligence and data science. So if you know how to write programs, it will definitely help. If you know how to write programs, if you know how artificial intelligence, yes, it will help. Machine learning, artificial intelligence. So, see, there is a lot of data available. Okay. So, if you know artificial intelligence and if I'm able to write a code or a program to extract what data is relevant to you, obviously it is going to help you. That's how it will help. Whose question is Prashant? Does that answer your question, Prashant?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Yes.
Anybody else with any other question? Yes, no? Okay. Quick introduction about myself. I don't want to waste too much of time. I'm a BCom CMA. I did my CMA in 2016. I'm one of the toppers. I repeat, I'm one of the toppers, not a rank holder, but a topper in CMA. I scored very good marks. Okay. I have over 25 years of experience with 15 years in the corporate world. Okay. More than 15 years in the corporate world. And I'm based in Bangalore. I'm based in north of Bangalore near a place called as Hebbal. Right? So that's about me. I'm a faculty with Uplift. I teach the CMA course. I'm also studying CPA. CPA is equivalent of Indian Chartered Accountant. It's certified public accountant like a CMA course. It is a professional course. It is equivalent to US CAs, or rather I should say it is US CA, equivalent to Indian CA. I am studying that course. I attend classes on Sundays and I love learning. So if you teach me something new, I will gladly learn. No person is small or big when it comes to learning for me. Even if you're my student and if you're able to teach me, I will gladly learn. Okay. That's about me. Any questions? Any questions? Any doubts? Okay. Now, before I go ahead, some etiquettes of attending the class. Okay. If you attend the class, it is going to be very beneficial for you. Recordings are not substitutes for live classes. When you are in the class, you can interact with me. You can ask me questions. You can, you know, clear your doubts then and there. If there's something you don't understand and you want me to repeat, I will be able to repeat it for you. But in a recording, you will not get that benefit. Okay. Even though what I teach gets recorded, you will not get the benefit of a live interaction. So if there's something in the recording you don't understand, it's going to be difficult for you to grasp. Right? So I encourage you all to attend the classes. Trust me, the value of attending the class is immense. I studied my CMA after 25 years of work experience, and attending classes was one of the biggest, you know, advantages for me. I attended each and every class, not a single class I missed, and it makes a lot of difference when you attend the classes. Okay, that's point one. Point two, you're here to learn and clear the course. You're not here just to attend the classes. You're not here just to read through the notes or read through the, you know, books. You are here to attend the classes. Be serious. Be, you know, determined, and be conscious that, you know, the faster you clear your exams and get your certification, the more doors will open for your career. So just don't attend the classes and say, okay, I will put off writing my exam to next week, next batch, next year. No. Be serious. It requires efforts. It is not difficult to pass this exam. At the same time, it is not even easy to pass the exam. It is easier than your ICW in India. It is easier than your CA in India. But it is not like your BCom or your BBA course where you can, you know, mug up in the last minute and then go and write your exam. Nothing like that. Here, your concepts are tested. Okay, they test you strongly on your concepts. So if your concepts are clear, if you have understood it, there are two things just to, you know, pass this exam. Very two critical things. One, very strong understanding of your concepts. Two is your time management. Both of these will come only with determination, dedication, and practice. It is very important that you understand this. The other thing is, this course is not cheap. Every time you write your exam, it costs anywhere between 15 to 25,000 rupees. Along with that, your IMA membership is required for you to write the exam. Your membership is for 1 year. So 1 year, if it expires, you'll have to renew your membership again. So it costs a lot of money to write this exam. It doesn't come cheap. Don't take it easy. Don't take it, you know, relaxed way. You have to put in an effort. Giving you my example again, when I was studying for this course, I used to attend weekend classes morning 9 to 5, Saturday, Sunday, both the days, morning 9 to evening 5 were my classes. Monday to Friday, I used to study. I used to revise what was taught to me over the weekend, solve problems, make notes of my, you know, doubts, so that I am able to go back on the next weekend and clarify everything I used to do. I used to study 3 to 4 hours on a daily basis. And bear in mind, like many of you all, I was also a working professional. It was not that I was only studying. I was also working at the same time. Are you all able to hear me? I have Sohil telling me not able to.
Yes, we can.
Yeah, Sohil, it seems to be a network at your end. So could be, you know, just a minute, a drop in the line. I spent time studying. Okay. And I cleared all my exams on the first attempts. Please do put in an effort. Don't, you know, take it lightly. It is difficult to balance work as well as studies, but you have to be determined and find ways to do that. Either you give dedicated time for your studies, or you find time between two, you know, meetings so that you can quickly go through one of the topics. How you do it is totally up to you. I was working as well as studying. That's a few things about the course. The third thing, etiquette, when you join the class, please mute your mic. Sorry, there's a well near my house. Okay. When you join the class, please mute your mic. Okay. Do not keep your mic on, because if there's a background noise, the others won't be able to hear you. You yourself won't be able to hear, and you will miss important points. Okay. These courses are on a tight timelines. They are on tight schedules. So I will go as, you know, evenly paced as possible. Okay. I will give you a lot of assignments. So when I cover a topic, I will do sample questions in the class, and I'll give you assignments. Please work on those assignments. Okay. The assignments which I give you will be exam level questions, the type of questions you can expect in your exam. I put in a lot of effort to gather the questions from various sources. Okay. Some of them you might see in your own course material. Some of them might be new to you. You will not find it, because I put in efforts to gather them from various sources. If you are given an assignment, even if it is there in your course material, still make an attempt. Right? I am available on mobile, I'm available on phone, as well as on an email. But I also work. Please bear that in mind. So if you have doubts or questions, email them to me. Drop me a note on the WhatsApp saying, sir, I've sent you an email. Can you please check? I will check and get back, ideally within 24 hours. Sometimes due to prior commitments or work pressures, it might be longer than 24 hours. You need to be patient. Right? If there is a concept which you don't understand and you would like to ask, okay, so what I usually do is, I don't keep the others waiting. So once the class is over, I am available. If you have any concepts which you would like me to explain, or any doubts which you want to ask me, I am available. I stay back for 5-10 minutes, okay, and I will explain during that time. That's about it. Yeah, I think that's about it. I've covered everything. I will share my mobile number as well as my email ID. Please make a note. This is my mobile number. Okay, please make a note. Everybody, please make a note. Right. And also one more thing. Okay, it doesn't make a difference about which course material you follow. Okay. So some of you might have Wiley, some of you might have Glime, some of you might have Hawk. It doesn't make a difference. It is important that you read through your course material, because I will not cover them each and every point of the course material. I will not go line by line. I will cover all the concepts, but there may be some key points like, you know, sometimes you have differences between, you know, advantages and disadvantages, which if you have a common sense, you should be able to do it even without reading. But there would be a need that to you read through the textbook, because there might be one or two points which will help you, additional one or two points which will help you when you read through the textbook. But I will cover major points, major parts of the the course will be covered. So with that, you should be able to write your exam and pass your exam. There should be no issues with that. Don't worry about which course material you are following. What is really important is you read the course material, okay, and attempt the questions in your question banks. You will have your question, you call it a question bank, you call it a test bank, whatever you call it. If you can attempt all the questions in your question bank, if you can get your hands on another service provider's question bank, you can use that as well to solve the questions. There's no harm in you solving more questions. But what I can tell you is 80%, irrespective of whether it is Hawk, Glem, or Wiley, or Becker, or whichever you want to take, 80% of the questions will be the same with little bit of variations. 80% of the questions are same. So if you are able to crack your own question banks well, it should be good enough. No issues with that. You don't have to break your head on which question bank to use or which question bank, sir, I am following, and which question bank you have got. No issues with that. Just solve the questions. If your concepts are clear, you should be able to solve the question of any question bank. If you get stuck, send me the questions along with the correct answer, because I will have to validate my working and tell you, yes, this is the correct answer. It's the same answer I'm getting. Okay? So send me the question and the answer. I don't need the workings of the question. How you got the answer, I don't need that. All I need is A, B, C, D is option. Question is this. Correct option is C. That's it. I will solve it and I will send it back to you. Right? That's about etiquette parts of it. Any questions on these before we begin the class? I want to make things very clear. I'm repeating. So, and the other thing, yeah, one more thing. If you miss a class, it is your responsibility to catch up what you missed. I'm not going to repeat everything. Okay? It is your responsibility to catch up what you missed. So if you missed last week's class, or let's say, you know, today's Monday and you missed last Monday's class, it is your responsibility to catch up and come prepared to the class when you come to this week's class. I will not repeat all the concepts, because sometimes what happens is I would have finished the concept and the next class I will be doing only the questions, or I would have done half the concept and next part of it will be a continuation of that. Okay? So if you have not caught up on what was taught, you will not understand what is being taught. Okay? It will be a disconnect between what I'm teaching and what you have missed. So you'll not be able to connect everything to understand the entire concept. And then if you come back and tell me, please explain me the whole concept, it's going to be very difficult for me. It's not that I won't do it, but it is very time consuming. So I won't be able to explain it that much detail as I would do for the class. Okay. That's another thing. Also, sometimes, you know, there are issues with the recordings. Even though we record the classes, technical glitches happen, they don't get recorded, and if you have missed the class, you will not even have the recording. So it is always advisable to attend the classes. Okay? Irrespective of whether the recording happens or does not happen, it is always advisable to attend the classes so that you are able to understand. Even if there's no recording, you have gone through the topic. That's in brief about the etiquettes and the classes and how it is done and all that. The other thing, I use a whiteboard. I will share the whiteboard with you all so that you can see it. Can everyone confirm that you are able to see the whiteboard? Anybody who is not able to see the whiteboard? Okay. this is the whiteboard I use. I write on it. I solve questions. So you will have the question as well as the solution being shown side by side so that you are able to understand. You see the question and you're able to see the answer as well. How I'm getting the question as well as the answers. Okay. Just to show you how it works, I will do that as well. Just give me a minute. Okay, can everyone confirm that you're able to see the question bank as well? You can see both question bank as well as the whiteboard. So I will look at the question here and I will solve it here. Okay, that's how I work. Right? Any other questions, any doubts? Anybody else has any other question or any doubt? Anybody wants to ask me anything before we begin the class?
Sir, one question, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, how long the recording will be accessed by us, sir?
Okay. So once the class is over, it takes about a day for the recording to get uploaded. And okay. Somebody from the Uplift admin team will send you a link to your email ID. Okay. You should download the recording and save it on your computer because there is a limitation of space offered by Cisco. Okay, it's on cloud. There's a limitation of space. After some time, the recording gets deleted. So the moment you get your link, it is always advisable to download the recording and save it on your computer, either on your desktop or on your, if you have an external hard drive. Save it on your external hard drive, whichever works best for you.
Okay.
Right? Okay, any other question?
Thank you.
Welcome. Any other question? Anybody wants to ask, so what will be the duration of the complete part two classes so we can plan the exam accordingly? Right. It is between 3 to 4 months. Depending upon, you know, how quickly you all are able to grasp. If people grasp the concepts quickly, able to understand the concepts quickly, and are comfortable with solving the problems and things like that, about 3 to 3.5 months. If not, it goes up by, you know, another 2 weeks or so. So we are in now what? We are in March. The next window is May, June, right? May, June is too short. You will not get sufficient time to prepare as well. You can target for the September, October window and you should be comfortably able to, you will get enough time to prepare yourself as well. If you are planning to write the exam, write as many mock exams as you can, full mock exams. I'm repeating, full mock exams, which means 100 MCQs and essay questions timed for 4 hours. In those mock exams, if you're able to score above 85%, then only you should be attempting the real exam. Okay? And I say 85% consistently. It is not that you write 10 exams and in one exam you score 85%. But you write 10 exams, at least 7 to 8 exams, you should score 85% or above. Then only you are prepared, you are ready to write the exam. That's the level of difficulty. Any other question? Anybody else wants to ask? Anybody? Any other question? I'm spending today's class time just to give you a background and understanding, clear all your doubts so that you're prepared to, you know, go through this thoroughly. Which material is better? It really makes no difference. All the materials are approved by IMA. All the materials are approved by IMA. you have a question bank, the same thing, you write the same question bank 10 times, 50 times, it doesn't make any difference. Okay, the thing is, even though you, when you see the question, you know the answer. Okay, because you have written a mock exam earlier, the same question had come earlier, so the moment you see the question, you know the answer. But what is important is for you to solve it, not just because you know the answer, don't just tick the answer and come. Solve it. Are you able to get to the answer by solving the question? That will be more important for you. Okay. How can you get question bank? Question bank is a part of your course material. Okay, so when you buy your course material, question bank, whichever, whether if you bought Gleam, question bank of Gleam will be a part of your course material. If you bought Wiley, Wiley's question bank will be a part of your course material. If you bought Hawk's question bank will be part of course material. So somebody has asked me, how do we get more mock tests? Okay, so one of the methods I adopted. Okay, so one of the methods I adopted was, when I was studying, I had Wiley material and Wiley question bank. Okay, and there was somebody in my batch who had Hawk material and Hawk question bank. So I exchanged my Wiley with Hawk to solve the questions. So I would take his login ID and password, log into Hawk and write the exam. And I would make a note on the date I wrote the exam, what time I wrote the exam and how much I scored. Okay. And I would give Wiley login ID to him for him to attempt Wiley mock exam. So we used to exchange and solve. Okay. It is not, I would not say it is ethical, but it is one way for you to learn, or if you want to do more mocks, that is one way. Okay, it depends upon how much of good coordination as classmates or as batchmates you have. Okay, that's the question. So Vinny, does that answer your question? Vinny had asked me this question. Right. Anybody else? Any other questions? I'm spending time in taking you through everything so that you get serious about your exam. Trust me, it is not child's play that you go write your exam and you clear it. It is not like your university exams. Your concepts are very strongly tested and they're tested in the limited amount of time. I'm not trying to scare you all. It is not that it is not achievable. It is much easier than your Indian ICWA and your Indian CA, but at the same time, it is not child's play. You need to be serious. And I'm sure you all are grown-ups. You all, are professionals who work. I'll answer that in a minute. I'll answer that question. You're professionals who work. You know the importance of, being dedicated, being determined, and being serious about what you take up. I don't have to go into that. How can we manage time during test? Practice, practice, practice. When you write your first mock, you will find that you ran short of time and you couldn't answer 4 questions. Okay? So you might want to practice, practice, and practice so that you get up to speed and you know what information to look for in the question and how to solve it. That will give you that will come only with practice. That is one part. The second part is, if you're stuck on a question, don't waste your time on that question. Choose the option which you feel is correct. Choose that option, flag the question and move on. If you have the time in the end, you can always come back to the flagged question and spend more time thinking how it should be solved. Okay. In the exam, in the real exam, do not leave any question unattempted. Underline the word. Do not leave any question unattempted. I will tell you what the logic is. Okay. Let us say you have 5 questions and you have only 10 seconds to answer. I will come back to that in a minute, Gaurav. Can you please hold on to your question? I will come back to a minute. Let us say you have 5 questions and you have 10 seconds to answer. In 10 seconds, you cannot solve 5 questions. but in 10 seconds you can mark 5 answers. Okay, so A, B, C, D is the option. So let us say I choose option B. So question number 95, 96, 97, 98, no, yeah, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100. Five questions, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100. Okay, for all the questions, I mark B, 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 B. I'm not even going to look at solving it. At random, I chose B as the option and I marked B for all the five questions in 10 seconds. Okay. Trust me, at least one of them will be correct. Okay. The probability of one of the questions being correct is very high. And that one question could be a deciding factor between you passing or you failing. Okay. That is why I repeat, do not leave any question unattempted. Make sure you attempt all the questions. Okay. If you don't have the time, choose whatever option you want. Take a chance, but do answer it, do mark it. That's one point. So coming to negative marking, no, there's no negative marking. Having said that, you don't know which question carries how many marks. Okay. You don't know because the marks are not mentioned for each question. 100 questions, 400 marks is all they tell you. How it is divided between those 100 questions, you will not know. Right? So it could be that one question which you left unanswered could be 5 marks, and that could be a line between your passing and not passing. Right? So please do answer all the questions.
So sir, go out of this side. So sir, I just wanted to ask, like in MCQ there are 100 questions, right? And yes. Each question is having a different distribution of marks.
Yes, you are right.
Okay,
you are right. 400 marks is divided between 100 questions, but how much marks is given for each question, you will not know. It will depend upon the difficulty level. It will depend upon the complexity level. If it is an easy question, the marks might be less. If it is a more difficult question, the marks might be more. I'm saying might be. Okay, because even I don't know that. Gaurav, does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. And I was just thinking, like, how to identify the highest marks question first.
You can't identify. Mm-hmm. That's how the exam is devised.
Right.
The other thing is, you will go to the essay questions only when you get 50 of the 100 multiple choice questions correct. I'm not saying 50 marks. I'm saying 50 of the 100 multiple choice questions correct. Then only you will go to the essay part. If not, you will not even go to the essay part. Okay. Any other questions? Any other doubts? Is financial calculator enough for solving the questions, or do we need any other? You can't use a financial calculator in the exam. You can only use a calculator which has four basic functions: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, square root. That is all. You cannot use a financial calculator in the exam. Don't worry about all that. You will come to a point when you, before you write your exam, okay, you can go through the IMA website which has all the details. Don't worry about that. That is very far. Right now, you need to focus on your course, getting your concepts right, and practicing your questions. That is more important now. Okay. Any questions around what I've talked about, for the class, how I teach, what is important to attend, all that. If you have any questions on that, ask me now. No,
please, sir. I have one question, sir.
Yes,
sir. So before going to class, can you please give me the brief of your type of terminology, the way of explanation, the way of asking questions? Can you brief me?
When you say the way of asking questions, Why will I ask questions?
You just said that after completion of that concepts, you will give an assignments and questions.
Yes. So what I do is I complete the concepts. So let's say in the concept there are, you know, three different types of questions. Okay. If I, for example, let us take accounts receivable. Okay. There are three different ways they can ask you questions in accounts receivable. So I will do at least one question of each of these types, and I will give you assignments for you to solve similar type of questions.
Okay.
You can solve it and email it to me.
Okay, sir.
Harish, does that answer your question? So what I do is, I ask you to take a screenshot of the question. Okay. The question, so it will be displayed like this. The question will be displayed like this, and let's say I want you to take a screenshot of question number 13. I will tell you, please take a screenshot of question number 13. You take a screenshot, save it on a Word document or wherever you want. Okay, you solve it and send it to me.
Okay.
I will tell you whether your answer is right or wrong. If it is wrong, I will give you an explanation. If it is an easy question, I will ask you to solve it again. If it is not an easy question, then I will tell you, okay, this is how you solve it. This is the right answer. This is how you got the answer. Even after that, if you have a doubt, after the class, you can stay back and I will explain it to you.
Okay, sir.
Vineet, are you there in the class? Is Vineet there in the class? Vineet, do you want to say how we solve the question? Do you want to talk a little bit about that? Because you have attended my previous class. Vineet is there. Jaspreet is there. Whoever wants to talk.
Sure.
You will have attended.
Sure,
you will have attended my classes. Yeah.
Sure, sir. That in these classes, sir is showing the questions to us, and he gives us the time. And that time period, we need to solve it. And after that, he will explain what actually the answer and how it will be arrived to that answer. What is the concept on that particular question? So this is the way how he is explaining the how we are practicing with him in the classroom on the problems.
And the homeworks also, you can talk about that, Vineet.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sir is providing us the homeworks also. He's giving, as he said, he is getting problems, numericals from different resources, and he's giving us to solve it in a homework. And next day it will be discussed in the classroom, and the concept for that particular problem, and if any doubt is there, that all will be clear in the classroom.
Right. Thanks, Vineet. Anybody
thank
else
you,
has
you,
any other questions on this? Any part of it? Harish, does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
You're welcome. Right. Okay. That's about the entire introduction. It's taken me an hour to introduce a lot of things, but it is a time well worth spent because it is important for you all to understand all of this. Right? So let's get down to the class now. So I'm going to talk briefly about, you know, what we are going to study. So we're going to study part two, which is strategic financial management. Before I go ahead over there, it doesn't make a difference which part you write the exam first, whether you write part one or part two, it doesn't make a difference. You can study both of these parts independently, and you can write part two first before you even write your part one exam. There's very little overlap, hardly about 5-6% overlap between these two parts, which is not, you know, not very drastic also. It's very basic overlap you will find. So you can study part two, write your exam part for part two before you study part one and write your exam for part one. Okay, that's another thing. So what I'm going to be starting with is financial statement analysis, it has a 20% weightage in your exam. Okay, so bear in mind, I'm saying 20% weightage. I'm not saying 20 questions in the exam. I'm saying 20% weightage based on marks given for each question. I don't know how many marks are given. So you might have only 7 or 8 questions which have 20% weightage, or you might have, you know, 35 questions which have 20% weightage. I don't know that. Okay. But the weightage is 20% for this particular topic. It is a scoring topic because a lot of it is numericals. Okay. It is difficult to, you know, it's not impossible, but it is tricky to score in a word problem because understanding the way the answer is framed is a little tricky in word problems. Okay. I will explain to you what word problems are again. Give me a minute. So can you all see question number 11? Sorry, question number 13, not 11, question number 13. Is everyone able to see question number 13? These are called word problems because the solutions is usually a sentence. It's an option. Okay. And if you look at question number 12, okay, these are called numerical problems because the solution is calculating values, calculating numbers. Okay, that's the difference between a numerical problem and a word problem. Word problem, you have to be very, you know, thorough in concepts as well as the theoretical part of it. Numerical problem, it is just calculations. It's easier to, you know, solve and easier to score as well. If you get your answer right, you get your score. Okay, it's the same with the word problem also. In word problem, you will find answers are very close. So you will have to think through your answers before you mark your answers. That's it. So there's a 20% weightage for financial statement analysis. Lot of calculations, lot of numerical problems. So it should give you, you know, easy chance to score if your concepts are strong, if you practice well, and if you attempt these questions, you know, well, thoroughly, so that you know you're clear with the concepts as well as how to solve them, right? That's about the thing. There's a lot of formula in this. Okay, there are a lot of formulae in this topic. I will share some tips and tricks on how to remember some of these formulae, how you know to identify these calculations. So it will be good if you attend the classes and get them first hand, because like I told you, you will have an opportunity to ask me a question then and there. How and why, you will have an opportunity. So it will be good if you use this, attend these classes and get a first hand knowledge of this. That's about it. So are we ready to start with today's class? Is everyone ready? Everyone excited to start with the journey? Okay, we have a lot of people from, you know, accounting background. So what do you understand by the term financial statement analysis? What do you understand by the term financial statement analysis? Profit and loss.
Financial health of the business, that is profit and loss, as well as balance sheet, cash flow.
Okay, knowing the health of the company, ratios. Okay, why ratios? Why solvency, liquidity? Yes, why solvency, liquidity? Why cash flow? Why ratios?
Providing a strategical input to the organization and the management to take a better future decision to plan strategical things in the future.
Okay, looking into the PL balance sheet and identify different ratios and interpret. Why do you want to look, interpret the ratios? Why do you want to do that?
Comparison of last, the base year.
Why do you want to compare? So, capacity of the business to pay liability in full and cash convertible liquidity. Okay. Right. Okay. So I had a person who's in the banking field. Who's that, please? I can't remember the name.
So me, Anirban.
Anirban. You are in the proper banking field, isn't it?
Yes, yes, sir.
And you are in retail banking, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I come to you and I tell you, 150 lakhs loan. Will you just give it to me?
No, sir. We will actually go through the balance sheet and profit and loss. And
why do you go through the balance sheet? Why do you go through the balance sheet?
To find out if the particular company has the capability to repay the credit.
Right. So you want to know whether I have the financial ability to repay the amount I'm borrowing or not.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Let's pick another person. Who? Hey, just give me a minute. I'm just looking at names and I'll just pick at random somebody. Okay, we have Vijay, not Vijay CS, Vijay, only Vijay. Vijay, can you please unmute your mic and talk?
Sure, sir, I'm here.
I give you 50 lakh rupees and I tell you, go and invest, okay, in a company. I want you to invest 50 lakh rupees in the shares of a company. What will you do?
So, yes, I mean, just to pick on the thoughts of the other people, yes, I need to understand the financial health of the company, you know, basically look at the profitability and their strategy as well. So, you know, these are the two items which I look at and then, you know, make a decision on whether I should invest or not.
Why do you want to look at the profitability?
Because the thing is that, you know, profit is something which everybody looks for. I mean, both as an investor as well as for the company perspective, profit is something which is extremely important. So, you know, that's the reason why we need to maximize our return on the amount, you know, the 50 lakhs which we are investing, and hence we need to put it in a company which is financially healthy.
Okay. So let me just take another person. So let's look at what Vijay CS has got to say about this. Which is the same 50 lakhs I ask you to invest. What will you look at?
So hi Sanjay. So my baseline will still be looking at a profitable source. And of course for the, you know, longevity. So how far the company has been performing at this profitability rate.
Okay. So anybody disagree with Vijay and Vijay CS? Anybody who's got a different view? Anybody who's got a different opinion? Anybody who thinks differently?
Hello. So I would look at solvency of the company. I would look at the cash flow of the company because I want to look at whether the company is solvent enough, because profitability doesn't mean that the company is profitable, but they are having a huge outstanding, huge receivables, which they are not able to pay it off. So I would like to look at...
Is it receivables or is it payables?
Payables. Both. Receivables as well. Like, they might be having a lot of receivables, which they have carried forward, but they are. It might be classified as bad debt.
Uncollectible.
Uncollectible bad debt, but they are showing it as receivable,
okay,
in case of most of the banks. So I would like to look at the cash flows, what the cash flows of the company is having currently, and whether they are solvent in future years. Definitely, I'll be looking at the profitability, how they're managing the cash. But most importantly, I will be looking at the cash flow and free cash flows of the company.
Why will you look at solvency?
Because I think if the company is solvent enough, like the company is cash flow rich, the company can invest or company can make more financial and more different choices, better choices.
All right. So anybody has any other view?
So, you know, before investing, I will definitely see the historical data and see how much, you know, return they have given to the shareholders and, you know, to the and, you know, what amount at what exponential rate, you know, they are increasing and what strategy they have, not on the, you know, quantitative side, but also from the abstract quality side, what their management is, how they strategize themselves and what is their future vision. And what are their goals, so that you know that give the envisage to a person who is investing into their company, provides a glimpse, like, you know, where the company will go in future.
Right. Okay. Now I'm going to ask you all a question. Has any one of you heard about a company called as Satyam Computers?
Yes, Mr. Raju, right?
Yes.
Yes.
So, do you all think Satyam Computers was not solvent? Do you all think Satyam Computers was not profitable?
Yes, it is profitable indeed.
Then, if it is profitable, was it not solvent? Right. So what went wrong over there?
Manipulation of accounts.
Yes, manipulation of accounts, agreed. But what went wrong?
Window dressing.
Yes, it was window dressing.
Yes.
Okay. Window dressing, cooking up the books. What you call as cooking up the books. So whatever you said today, you talked about solvency, you talked about cash flow, you talked about profit and loss, you talked about, you know, strategy, all of that is important. Along with that, it is also to know what is the true picture of the company. Okay. Books, even though they are cooked up, somewhere or the other, there will be something to indicate that something is amiss or something is wrong. If you study that in detail, if you study it very, very carefully, okay, you will realize that, you know, okay, something is wrong. You might not be able to put your finger immediately on what is wrong, but you will definitely sense that, you know, this does not match up. If I compare last year or 2 years back's numbers with this year's numbers, it does not match up. If I compare this, let's say, you know, let's say it's a manufacturing concern, the inventory versus, you know, the sales, it does not match up. Something is somewhere missing. Something, some connection, some link is missing. Key parameter is missing. So whatever you said, solvency, cash flow, profitability, all of that is important, along with understanding the true picture. Like somebody mentioned, health of the organization. The second point. So people, when I told them, I'll give you 50 lakhs, go and invest in shares of a company. What did you all talk about? You talked about profit, how profitable the company is. Okay. And what is the, you know, history of the company? How much return does it give? All that you talked about. But did anybody think about safeguarding their 50 lakh rupees? It's already, if you don't make money out of it, it's already, if you don't make a profit out of the 50 lakhs after investing, if you don't make a profit, it's all right. But would you like to lose 50 lakhs? And let's say if that 50 lakh become 25 lakhs or, you know, 30 lakhs, would you like that? Would you like to lose your capital? No, right? So what you would do? You would like to invest in the company where, after studying the company's financial health, okay, after looking at the management, the way the company is managed, after looking at the business of the company, after looking at the environmental conditions or the economic conditions of the, you know, the country and things like that, along with studying the balance sheets, the financial statements of the company, you will invest in that company only when you feel that your money, your capital is going to be safe and will give you some return. Let me give you a simple example. Okay. 50 lakh rupees, I told you, go and invest in a company. Right. Now, I asked you to invest in the shares, and there is a company which gives you a return of 5% on 50 lakhs per annum, a return of 5% per annum on 50 lakhs. Okay. Will you go and invest over there? I've looked at the history of the company. The company is solvent. Okay. The company is profitable. I give you the money, 50 lakhs, and say, go invest in this company's shares. And the return you can expect, based on the past historical data, based on your calculations and all that, you can expect a return of 5% per annum. Will you go and invest over there? Will you go and invest in the shares of that company? So let's again pick a person. Who shall we pick? Vishal. Vishal is here for a demo class, is it?
Yes.
You're here for a demo class, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, we'll still have a conversation. Anyway, we'll have a conversation. I gave the 50 lakhs to you. Asked you to invest in a company which gives a 5% annual return. Will you go and invest?
Yes, sir.
You will. Okay, let's ask another person. Okay, let's ask another person. Okay. So let's ask Ramiz. Ramiz.
Yes, sir.
Will you invest the 50 lakhs in the company which gives you a 5% annual return?
I will have to first compare with the industry standards, and also I have to analyze what I'll be getting if I'm going to invest in bank or any other company. So it depends on, so I'll have to compare my return and then I'll decide that.
Okay, so let's say the industry average is 5%.
Okay, in that case, again, if the industry average is 5%, then I'll look into the how quick I'm going to get that, or the cash flow or efficiency of the company. So if they can really generate the income, and also the products, apart from the financial aspect, I'll see what item they are dealing with, if it has the future, and if that is being most demanded in the market. So these are all aspects I'll be seeing.
Right. Okay, so Vizwan, why will you compare it with a risk-free return?
I want to see like what's the FDs, like what the banks are offering right now. Mm-hmm. If the banks are offering more than 5%, then definitely it's less risk if I invest in the bank rather than putting the money in a company. Because so if the bank is offering me more, I would definitely go with the bank on the FD side. And if the bank is not offering me more, and if the industry average is 5%, then we look into the credibility of the company, and then we can decide on that.
Okay, let's twist this question now. Mm-hmm. The bank FD rate is also 5% now.
Then I'll put in the bank FD.
Why?
Because it's safe. It's much safer.
Safe, no risk. Or minimal risk.
Minimal risk.
Okay. It is minimal risk. So what are you really looking at? You're looking at keeping your capital safe.
Safe.
Okay. Before you start earning profits. Right? That's your aim, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So it's the same. It is the same. When you're doing a financial analysis, that is the same reason. Why do your financial analysis? You want to know that, is it safe for me to put my money into this company? Will I lose? Right? Before you even think of return. So that is one of the reasons why you do a financial statement analysis. I said one of the reasons. There could be various other reasons. Can somebody tell me? So let's pick somebody and see if he's able to answer. Who have we got? Okay, Vijay. Vijay?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Right. Can you think of any other reason why you would do a financial analysis? Or financial statement analysis? Can you think of any other reason?
I mean, risk. I mean, risk is one of the important aspects of it. One thing which actually came across my mind was the inflation part. I mean, if the inflation or, you know, maybe, let's use the words inflation is much more than the number, then definitely, you know, we do not want the wealth to get eroded over a period of time. So that's why we need to invest in companies wherein, you know, it's above the it covers the inflation as well as, you know, which is financially healthy. So, you know, maybe that might be one of the reasons.
Right. Anybody else can think of any other reason why you would like to do or why you would want to do a financial statement analysis? Credibility. So we already talked about risk, isn't it? We talked about the risk of investing in the business. So you want a capital to be stable. Working capital status. So what do you mean by working capital status, Harshita?
Means the current assets.
Okay.
Which will be required for day-to-day operations. How smooth we can take the operations.
So what would you understand by analyzing the working capital?
Like procurement.
Sorry?
Procurement of raw materials.
Procurement of raw materials. Okay.
And
anybody payments. Else? Right. Anybody else with any other answer? Any other thought? No? Okay. Trend analysis, okay. What else?
Ability to meet short-term and obligations, sir.
Short-term obligations, okay. Right. So let's pick somebody who's not spoken over here. Anybody who's not spoken. Sohail, Imran, or Sadiq, one of you. Whoever can talk. Sadiq, can you talk? Can you unmute your mic and talk? Okay, your mic is having issues. How about Sohail, Imran? Sohail, can you unmute your mic and talk? No. Internal controls. Okay. Let's talk to Amit Pal. Amit.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me talk to you because there's nobody. Now, you are a businessman. You have a big company. Okay. And I asked you to. Or you are looking at taking over another, let's say your company's name is ABC, okay? And okay. You are looking at taking over XYZ company.
Okay.
Will you just go and take over that company?
No, definitely not.
So what will you do?
So to take over a company, first of all, I will look into the market holding of that company. So how much share that company is holding into that. So because that will directly link with to the revenue of the company. So this is the first thing I will look into it. Then the second thing I will look into it, the stockholding of that company. How many investors they got, how much EPS, the earning per share they are giving. I will also look into the different aspects like DPO or DSO of the company. Then definitely cash flow and everything. So in cash flow, there are three sections. So my first priority will be to look into the income from operations. So for me, that will be the priority because operations is the only thing through which a company earns the money. if it is earning from the other sources, then that won't be my first priority. Then apart from that, I will also look into their debt side. So how much debt they are carrying with them and for how many years, I mean, long term or short term debt, definitely. If the long term is more, then their business is not doing that much good.
So can I say, in short, you will look at whether it is financially viable to take over that company or not?
Yes, financially viable. And also, will that, like, if I take over, and will I be able to earn profit from their business or not?
That is synergy part of it. The synergy part of with your business, right?
Okay.
So another reason why you would look at the financial statement is if you're looking at mergers and acquisitions. Mm-hmm. Right. And somebody rightly pointed out, you will also look at it because it is a necessity by law. It is a necessity by regulation to publish your financial statements so that people who want to invest in your company are aware of the financials of the company and can make an informed decision whether they want to invest in your company or not.
But only public limited companies are liable to publish.
Even private?
No, not all the privates. I'm saying this because recently I started doing the investor analysis report, and I come across number of big companies. For example, the History Channel. So that's a private company. They don't have their.
But if you are looking to take over that company or merge your company, you will always ask for the financial statements, isn't it?
Yes.
We're not looking at whether they're published or not published. We are not looking at whether they're published. Right. So if you are going to make a decision to invest in that company, you need to see the financial statements because you want to make an informed decision whether you want to go ahead with the investment in that company or not. Right. That's the point. Right.
Yeah. So before merger, I have to do my due diligence as well.
Yes. Or even if you're not merging, even if you're lending money to them, don't you want to see whether the company is sound or not? So you will ask for the financial statements, isn't it?
Yes, I will.
That's the point. So there are various reasons why you will look at a financial statement analysis. It is not one typical reason, but there are various reasons. Okay. You might want to invest in the company. You might want to take over that company. You might want to lend money to that company. You want to see how that company is performing. Okay. Before you think of taking any action, there could be various reasons. You could be a government official who wants to make sure that the company is complying with the financial requirements of the law. It could be various. Okay. So what is it that you're going to study under this? You're going to study that. You're going to look at operating income, net income, earnings before interest and taxes, earnings after taxes, how many times the inventory is bought and sold, how many times the company's debts are collected and reinvested. How many times does the company make payments to its suppliers in a year? All of these. What is the return on its invested on the equity? What is the return on the capital? Return on equity is nothing but return on capital. Equity is nothing but your capital. What is the return on equity? What is the return on all the assets the company owns? All of this is what you're going to study. So you're going to look at various ratios. These ratios are going to tell you how sound or how weak the financials of the company are. Okay? So before we go into anything, what we are going to study is operating income and net income. Okay? Where does the operating income come from? You sell goods which you have manufactured. From that, you take out the cost of manufacturing those goods. You get a gross profit. From that gross profit, you take out other expenses which are not related directly to manufacturing, okay? Which are not directly related to the product cost. Product cost is something which is involved in the manufacture of the product. Okay, when we talk about manufacture, it could also be buying and selling, but we usually use the word manufacturing over here. Okay? So you take out all the administrative expenses to arrive at an operating income. Okay, from that operating income, when you take out your interest and dividend income, okay, interest which you earned sorry, when you add the interest which you earned and minus the interest which you paid out. Okay, so if you have lent money, you will get interest. Okay, if you have borrowed money, you will have to pay interest. So after you adjust, okay, after you adjust all this interest, you gain, you get something called as earnings before taxes. It's called as earnings before tax. So operating income will usually be earnings before interest and taxes. Then you have earnings before taxes. Then on the balance money, you will pay your taxes to get your earnings after taxes or your net profit, what you would call as EBT, net profit. To that net profit, okay, you will add either or deduct, you will either add or deduct gains or losses on discontinued operations to get your net income. Okay, so you have your revenue minus the cost to manufacture, which give you a gross profit, minus all the indirect expenses which are not directly related to your manufacturing, will give you an operating income. Okay, plus or minus your interest and your non-operating gains and losses. What are non-operating gains and losses? It could be something like, you know, you bought foreign exchange because you want to pay your supplier in the foreign exchange. Okay, but before you could make a payment, let us say the exchange rate has changed. So either you are making a profit because the value of that foreign exchange has gone up, or you're making a loss because the value of the foreign exchange has come down. That is non-operating gains and losses. You will adjust that to get income from continuing operations before income tax. Okay, so this is the income from continuing operations. What is your regular, what is the income in your regular course of business? Okay, then provisions for income tax. So you will pay income tax on that to give you income from continuing operations. To that, either you will add a loss, so either you will add a gain or you will deduct a loss from discontinued operations. So let me give you an example. You are a car dealer, you have a car showroom as well as a service center. Okay, but you find that the service center is not profitable, it is not working out for you. So you discontinue that service line of business, let's say midway in a year. So when you hive off, when you sell off that business, or when you wind up that business, it could be either of those. Either you sell it off or you wind it up. Okay, when you have a gain or a loss, that will be the gain or loss on discontinued operations. Okay, that is after your taxes. After you have paid your, if there's a gain, you would have paid taxes. If there's a loss, you will get a tax benefit. Okay, that after you deduct or you add gains and losses on discontinued operations, you will get your net income. That net income is what you distribute to your shareholders, a part of it, or it is called as a distributable income. Part of it you would give it away as dividends, okay, to your shareholders. Clear on operating income and net income? How do you differentiate operating income and net income? Okay, any questions? No? Okay, so what is earnings before interest and taxes? Everything, okay, you have done with the business, manufacturing, with your regular business is operating income. Okay, interest and dividend, if you have received, okay, interest and dividend, if you have received, will be added. Non-operating gains or losses, if it is gain, it will be added. If it is a loss, it will be deducted. Gains or losses from discontinued operations, after adjusting all this with the operating income, you will get earnings before interest and taxes. No, this is not right. Yeah, okay, you will get earnings before interest and taxes. Okay, after adjusting all of this, you will get your earnings before interest and taxes. What you need to keep in mind, your earnings before interest and taxes is not equal to operating income. They will be equal only if you do not have interest or dividend income, if you do not have operating gains or losses, if you do not have discontinued operations, And extraordinary events is no longer there. So you can just ignore it. Okay. Extraordinary events is no longer there. It has been removed from US GAAP. Okay. So basically what it says is, if all of these is not there, then only operating income is equal to earnings before interest and taxes. Okay. If any of these is there, it won't be equal to operating income, and earnings before interest and taxes will not be equal. There will be a variation. After you get earnings before interest and taxes, okay, you pay interest income, that is your earnings before taxes, to get your earnings before taxes. Okay. Here, interest and dividend usually is received, added. So you see a plus sign. Here's the interest you're paying. Okay, that's the difference. See this? Here's only interest added. Here it is gains and losses. Here also it is gains and losses. Here it is only interest which you receive to get your earnings before interest and taxes. From that earnings before interest and taxes, you will pay your interest on your borrowings to get your earnings before taxes. Okay. And then you pay your taxes to get your net profit. From your earnings before taxes, you pay your taxes, and whatever is left is your net profit. Any questions? Any doubts? Any questions? Any doubts till here? No? Okay. We have done with today's class time. It's 10:30. I will stop the class here. So this is just an introduction. Please do go back and revise so that you're comfortable with understanding what is operating income, what is net income, what is earnings before interest and taxes, what are the components which are included in earnings before interest and taxes, what is earnings before taxes, what are the components which are included in that, right? So that we can continue in tomorrow's class. I'm done with class. If anybody has questions, can stay back. If not, I will see you all tomorrow.
I actually, you know, I'm not able to understand that. You know, earning before interest and taxes.
Who's that?
Gaurav.
Gaurav. Okay. So, till operating income, did you understand?
Yes, till operating income, I understand what purchases minus,
Not purchases. It is sales minus sales, the cost to produce the goods. Minus all your administrative expenses will give you operating income. Okay.
Yes.
Sales from your operating, to your operating income, okay, add your interest and dividend. So let us say I'm an ABC company. Okay. I have surplus cash. So I lend that cash to another company, let's say XYZ, that XYZ will pay me interest, right? I will add that interest here, okay? And I give an example of foreign exchange. I bought foreign exchange to pay my supplier, but before I could pay my supplier, okay, the foreign exchange rate went up. Okay, that means the amount I'm holding has gone up. Okay, that is a non-operating because it is not a part of my regular business. But I still make a profit. If I sell it in the market, I will make a profit. So that is a non-operating gain or loss. I will add that gain. If it is a loss, I will deduct the loss. Okay. And I will get this part. Then gains from discontinued operations. So I gave an example of a service business, which I sold off because it is not profitable for me. I will reduce that loss. After I do all of these adjustments, I'll get operating income. And if I add the interest, add the gain or the loss from the non-operating business, or the deduct the loss from the non-operating business, add the gain from a discontinued business, or deduct the loss from a discontinued business, I will get earnings before interest and taxes. From this earnings before interest and taxes, I reduce the interest I pay on what money I have borrowed. Let us say I have borrowed money from the bank and I pay interest to the bank. That is your interest expense. So from the earnings before interest and taxes, after I reduce my interest expense, I will get earnings before taxes. From this earnings before taxes, I will reduce my tax liability, how much of income tax I have to pay. After I remove that income tax, I will get my net profit. Gaurav?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So Vijay has a query. What about depreciation, amortization? Will it be covered later? Depreciation and amortization will come in your income statement. So it will come over here. Selling, general, administrative, over there, because you're taking that out from your gross profit. They are not directly related to your product cost. Okay. So from that, you will take it out to get at your operating income. Vijay, clear? Yes, Harish, go ahead.
Sir, I would like to share my experience, sir. So yes. In my previous organization, one of the branch was closed, sir, because no revenue is getting from that branch.
Mm.
Already the company was shut down. But whatever the expenses is running out right now, was there may be salaries, there may be rent on that buildings. Because it is an it will be treated as in a discontinued operations only, sir. So whatever the expenses we are paying on behalf of that branch, can we take into this, sir, gain or losses on discontinued operations?
It is not yet discontinued. You have not yet stopped the operations there. You're still paying salaries. You're still running the that operation over there, isn't it? Even though you're not selling anything. Okay? You're still running the operation. So it cannot be from discontinued. Discontinued operations is totally wound up. Or it is sold off. Okay? Totally wound up. I liquidated all my assets, pay off all my liabilities. So if my assets were more, I will get a gain. If my liabilities were more, I will be under a loss. That is discontinued operations. Clear? You can classify it as discontinued operations, or because it is, you are in, see, we will study, when we study discontinued operations, it is there in part one. Okay. You can classify it as discontinued operations because you are in the process of winding it up or selling it off up to a period of 1 year. You have 1 year's time to either sell it off or to wind it up. Okay. And you can still classify it as discontinued operations.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Anybody else with any other question?
Sir, Anirvan here.
Yes, Anirvan.
Sir, actually, I had a little difficulty in understanding due to my background. But sir, just wanted to tell you, if you could just send across the notes, I will start preparing from the basics also as well.
So I'll make it simple for you, okay? Just for you to understand this. Let us say...
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let us say you run a shop. Okay, I'm going to use, let's not run a shop. You have a machine which you want to sell. Okay, you bought that machine for, let us say, $1,000. Okay, and you sold it for $1,400. Sales or service revenue is your $1,400.
Okay? Yes, sir.
Cost of goods sold is $1,000 which you spent on the goods, the cost of the goods which you sold, right?
Yes, sir.
That gives you a profit of 400. That is your gross profit. Okay.
Okay,
out of the 400, you spent, let us say, 100 for your sales representative. That is your selling, general, and administrative. So 300 is your operating income.
Okay, sir. All right, sir.
Right? Now,
right, sir.
That is your regular business. Okay. Now, you bought a machine for 1,000. Let us say you had 50,000 rupees. So what you did, 49,000 rupees, you lent it to your friend who's going to pay you interest. And he pays you interest of, let us say, 500 rupees every year. Okay. That is your interest and dividend income. Add that. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right. Now, that is your interest and dividend income. So operating income, you're adding your interest and dividend income. Now, I gave you an example that, let's say you also have entered into a contract with a company in China to import a machine. So you bought the yuan to pay them in the yuan, okay, and the price of that yuan fell. Okay, you bought it at 100 rupees, now it has become 95 rupees even before you make the payment. So you have a loss, right?
Right, right, sir.
That
absolutely
is your non-operating, that is your non-operating gain or losses. Okay, if it okay is a gain, you all will right add it. If it is a loss, you will minus it. So from your 300, you add 500 rupees interest, which your friend gave you. Now your income becomes 800. And let us say your loss is, let us say 50. Okay, so it becomes 750. And then let us say you also had another service center, which you sold it off because it was not your line of business. Okay, you invested in that service center. Let us say you invested 1,000, but you got back only 950 after you sold it. So how much loss did you make?
150.
9,000 minus 950 is 50.
Oh yeah, 9,000 minus 950, right? 50.
Okay. Sir, so yes, you had operating income of how much? 300.
Yes.
500 you got interest. 800. Interest.
50 rupees, right, from my non-operating loss.
50 rupees gone. So 750.
750.
You made another loss of 50 by selling off this business.
Right.
So how much have you got now?
700.
700 is your earnings before interest and taxes.
All right. Okay. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Now on that 700, you have to pay income tax. No. Let us say, so you got the 700. You got this earnings before interest and taxes. Now, because you are going to import a machine from China, you took a loan from the bank.
Right. Right, sir. Absolutely.
And
so we paid interest
to
on
the
it
bank. That is your interest expense. Let's right say 100 is your interest expense.
Right,
750
sir
minus 100.
700 minus 100 is 600.
600 is your earnings before taxes.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Now you have to pay income tax because that is your earnings.
Yes.
So when you, let's say you pay 25 as income tax.
Yes, sir.
So how much are you left with?
575
is your net profit.
Okay. Okay. Okay,
that
sir
is your net income, what you call as net income
net
or
income
net profit.
Right,
in
sir.
US
thank
terms,
you so much.
It is called, in US terms, it is called as net income. In India, it is called as net profit.
Okay, sir. I understood now. I understood clearly, sir.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I will send
yes
that
sir
link. I'll send it to Archana and I'll do it tomorrow morning. Send it
yes
to Archana
sir
and she will then, you know, forward it to you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I'll be...
You're welcome. You're welcome. Anybody okay else with any other question? No? Okay. Thank you, folks. Good night. Stay safe. I'll see you all tomorrow.
Thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome.
Good night, sir. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.